Well, whatever owns those warty-looking, lobstery hands is obviously not very nice. It's a safe bet they're the ones who are blowing up the oil rigs. But why? They have a kind of underwater look to them. Maybe Huckle's been building in their backyard or on their television aerials or something. Maybe they eat the stuff. After all, food scientists are busy figuring out ways to make food for us out of petroleum. If, that is, we don't burn up all the oil before we use up all the agricultural land. Well, maybe the rigs look like water spiders to the Zygons, too. Large water spiders. Or maybe Huckle's survey was not quite as intensive as he thought, and he did indeed plant a leg in a Zygon dormitory or a drill in a Zygon pantry. After all, a man who can talk about the sea being empty can be wrong about a lot of things. Of course, the main thing Huckle's wrong about is not exactly his fault. He's just part of the system. Right on, Doc. Aside from the fact that we may yet need that mineral slime for food if we don't start growing less people and more beans, the way we're scrabbling for oil now is a new low in intelligence even for Homo saps. If half the money, manpower, and management now being put into the search for Arctic oil, building giant pipelines and offshore platforms, cleaning up oil spills, were being put into developing ways of energizing hydrogen. That's fusion power, he meant. Or building solar power satellites, or setting up windmills, or studying ways of using tidal and geothermal power. If we were seriously putting a major investment of money and manpower into any or all of those alternatives, then I guess we'd be in real trouble. Or what most people apparently consider more serious trouble than polluting the seas, destroying the permafrost, and poisoning the air with fossil fuel emissions. I'm talking about money. If you think the world economy's in a bad way now with inflation due to the high price of oil, just think of the total economic collapse if the oil industry suddenly went out of business. Here's an example. This little device is called a radiometer. What's making it move right now is the TV lights, but take it out in the sun and it'll do the same thing. Make it a little, well, a lot bigger. Attach a drive shaft and you've got a working engine when the sun is out. Obviously, it's not as useful as solar collector panels working with a heat storage system, because a lot of the energy we need, especially heat and light, we need most when the sun's not out. Of course, when there is no sun, there may be wind. So suppose you had one of each in your backyard, or a bunch of them on the roof of your apartment building. They still wouldn't supply all your power, yours or mine or most North Americans. But they'd supply more power than most Asians or Africans or South Americans ever dreamed of having. I wonder how big this thing would have to be to run an automobile. I mean, a really lightweight car, maybe heavy craft board or even plastic. There's something to use the oil for instead of burning it up. Durable plastics for durable items. Okay, a really lightweight car that runs with a clockwork mechanism, a flywheel or a giant rubber band kind of thing, and the sun wheel turning keeps winding it up. How do you like that? Now, how do we keep our plastics manufacturing plants running and the folks in Inuvik or even Thunder Bay warm on the long winter nights? Well, there are two good heavy-duty long-range answers. One is solar satellite power. And the problem with that is money. If you're beaming down energy from a satellite, how do you make sure nobody can tap it without having to go through a meter first? Otherwise, how would the people who put the satellite up make any money out of it? Or even get their expenses back? Well, maybe they'll figure it out. If not, there's always fusion. And if that word worries you, remember that fusion and fission are not the same thing. Two big differences. First, a fission reactor needs radioactive fuels and produces radioactive wastes. A fusion system works on hydrogen and produces power and inert metals. The other difference, unfortunately, is that we know how to construct a fission reactor. And the only efficient use we have for fusion power so far is the hydrogen bomb. But if half the effort and money now being put into offshore oil and Arctic oil and tar sands were going into fusion research or into all the possibilities inherent in sun, wind, water, then we could look forward to a complete world economic collapse in the near future and maybe a safe planet.